Please attend it. That's a really great service. If you can, please be there for that service.
Even death are subject to your transforming power. We ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Yeah.
Today's affirmation of faith is number 884 in the handles. Lord, ask me to rise as I repeat our affirmation of faith. We believe in one God, creator and sustainer of all things, father of all nations, the source of all goodness and beauty, all truth and love. We believe in Jesus Christ, God manifest in the flesh, our teacher, example, and redeemer, the savior of the world. We believe in the Holy Spirit, God present with us for guidance, for comfort, and for strength. We believe in the forgiveness of sins, in the life of love and prayer, and in grace equal to every need. We believe in the Word of God, contained in the Old and the New Testaments, as the sufficient rule both of faith and of practice. We believe in the Church, those who are united in the living Lord for the purpose of worship and service. We believe in the reign of God as the divine will realized in human society and in the family of God, where we are all brothers and sisters. We believe in the final triumph of righteousness and in the life everlasting. Amen. Let's turn now to our neighbors in church, wave at them. Tell them you love them from a distance.
I invite you to join me now in a moment of silent prayer, or pastoral prayer, and then our Lord's Prayer. May we pray. Loving God, we thank you. We say thank you because we don't know what else to say for the love that continues to pour into us, through us, and around us. This day, Valentine's Day, we pay special attention, though it's really every day is Valentine's Day, just like every day is Easter. For both of these, say love is the central part of living. And we thank you. Your love sustains us. It heals us. It helps us. It gives us hope for a future. For that, we are grateful. We pray, Lord, for the needs lifted up, for those who are celebrating and those who grieve, for those who are searching for answers and for those who have a witness to bear. Father, we pray that you will lead us all in your way, that our lives may be used of you for the purpose of helping others to come to know you, to be transformed by your presence. And so this day of Transfiguration is one in which we celebrate the life-changing witness of you. Come, as we are a part of this service, transform our hearts, transform our lives, transform our relationships, that we might bear the witness of your love everywhere. We thank you, O Lord. We give you all the praise and all the glory through Jesus our Savior, and in his name, as he taught us, we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We say thank you for our offering, for those who continue to support us with your tithe, your gifts, and your offerings. They enable the mission and the ministry of this church to continue. And we pray that God will continue to work in your life and in the lives of all, that we might be a bearer of his good news into all the world. There's an offering plate at both entrances, both for your tithes and gifts, but also one for Change for Children you'd like to continue to support that as well, and we thank you.
We're singing a song called Testify to Love. Not just love, but the fact that God is love. And everything that God has created, He created with love and for love and to be love. And so this is our testimony to that, to God's goodness and love for all of His creation.
Amen.
Transfiguration Sunday, we read the story of Christ's transfiguration. Today from the Gospel of Mark, we're in the 9th chapter, reading verses 2 through 9. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice. This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him. Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
May we pray? Oh Lord, your real self is not as we imagine, and yet is greater than anything we can imagine. I pray, Lord, that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts may be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our strong rock and our Redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
If people ever need to know who I am, I have identification. I have a U.S. passport. I have a photo ID. I can pull out my driver's license and show you the mugshot they took a number of years ago. I have a marriage certificate, which lets everyone know that I'm proud to be married to this woman back here. I'm her servant. I also have documents that detail completed studies at prestigious universities so that you can be deemed, gosh, he must be a smart person, ha ha. It also says that I've completed all the requirements necessary to be an ordained elder in the United Methodist Church. I get to stand here, and that's part of my identification. But you know, most people don't care. They don't care about all this identification. If I'm going out, they don't check my driver's license. If I'm going somewhere to buy gas or go to the grocery store, they don't care. They want to know, do I smile? Do I act kindly? Am I polite? These are the things that matter. And what we have today is a witness of someone who has finally revealed what truly matters. It's Transfiguration Sunday, and as such, we, by following the Revised Common Lectionary as I do, always read from one of the gospel accounts of Jesus going up the mountain with Peter, James, and John and being transfigured before them. In that, he becomes glowing with light. His clothes are dazzling bright white, and that just astounds everybody. They look at that and they can hardly comprehend it. At the same time, we experience the presence of Moses and Elijah, and they come and they talk with Jesus. And then a cloud settles down upon them, and from the cloud a voice, the voice of God, speaks. This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him. Who's he talking to? He's talking to Peter, James, and John. These will be the disciples who will guide the movement of Christ followers forward. Why do we see this story every year? You know, we could think of many more things that we could read about that would probably be very interesting. And especially on this day, Valentine's Day, we can come up, I'm sure, with plenty of text that would be wonderful. But the reality is that what we are reading today is a testimony. A testimony to love. I'll take that from the, I'll pull back off the song every time I want to. But what it reveals to us is that God so loved the world that he gave his only son. And here we experience the reality that Jesus is that son. See, Jesus has just shown all of his identification. He is Son of God. He has the glow of God's presence. Some would refer to that as the Shekinah, the glow of God. He has Moses and Elijah speaking with him. And then the cloud, the very presence of God, we witnessed that in the descent upon the tabernacle when it was in the desert. And we see that as it filled the sanctuary after the temple was built. And we see this over and over as this witness to God being present with us. And to add to that, we hear the voice, "This is my Son, the Beloved." Now we know who Jesus is. Is it important? Absolutely. This world, much like that time back then, was having a hard time. We're going through a pandemic. And the pandemic has people struggling. How do we live? What do we do next? How are we supposed to get through these days? How do we deal with the reality that this is happening when we are supposed to have a loving God who prevents such things happening to us? This is the theodicy. That question of where is God? Why do bad things happen to good people? The question in our heart. You see, because it's all around us, and we're supposed to be those people who are so loved by God that we are carried in God's hands. We are protected. We are loved. We are helped. We're healed. We pray for these things. We pray for help, hope, and healing. We pray for God's presence to be felt by all. People look at us and they go, where's the help? I don't see any healing coming. It sure doesn't have much hope. And we sometimes struggle to come back to that. We struggle with what's that answer supposed to be. But I'll help you just a moment. You see, because God always has three answers possible. The first one is yes. You ask for it, you got it. The second answer is no, otherwise known as you really don't know what you're asking for. What you're asking for would be more harmful to you than you can imagine. The third answer is the one that we struggle the most with, and that third answer is wait. We don't like to wait. You see, because God's timing is a whole lot different than ours. If we can depend upon God to say wait, and only means, you know, like until tomorrow morning or something, well, we can probably easily do that. Maybe even until Wednesday. But boy, much beyond that, and we're starting to get real anxious. I'm sorry, God, you said you were going to do this. Where are you? We like to have things sort of happen in our time frames. But God says, you know, I'm working out something here that you can't even begin to comprehend. What I'm doing will be for the best and the benefit of everybody. Wait for it. We don't like the idea of 40 years wandering in the wilderness. We don't like the idea of being 40 years in Babylon. We don't like the idea of even 40 minutes of having to listen to a preacher just go on and on and on. We instead want something to be handed to us now. Let's do it. Let's get it done. Let's go forward. And so when we come to that, we look at what's going on in our lives and we say, okay, I'm going to give God the room here to continue to work. We have the pandemic, we have the struggles, we have the civil unrest, we have the constant fighting to have the most power, to have the most possessions, to have the most prestige. We have this constant battling between people. And we wonder, okay, how are we supposed to do this? How are we supposed to respond to it? And then we come to this text. Okay. Do I need to be reminded year after year that Jesus is God? Do I need to have it preached at me one more time of how he talked to Elijah and Moses? What's that about anyway? Do we need to have this message about the cloud descending? Okay, yeah, that was sweet. God coming down, this is my Son, thank you. He does that a couple of times in the Gospels. But I remember all of that stuff. So why are we here? I was reading a devotional today, and the writer is Beth Richardson, who is part of the Upper Room family up in Nashville. And she was talking about working with the Academy of Spiritual Formation and how in those week-long events, you go and you spend time together and you delve deeply into worship, into to prayer, into the time together of knowing and searching out God's love, God's will, God's presence for you. And she says, every year when that week is over, I head back home and I am still on the mountaintop. I am still filled with this overflowing love. And it just feels like all the world is good, but then I come back to my home and then the issues of the week start to slowly crowd in upon that. And it's back to washing clothes and going to the grocery store and cooking meals and cleaning the house. And pretty soon all of that high that I had coming back from the mountaintop is dissipated, gone away. She said, but you know, year after year after year, spending that time on the high mountain and then coming back, a little bit of that tends to last a whole lot longer. And so I come back and I begin to realize that God is present in the low places too. It's not just up on the mountain where I get to see Jesus transfigured. It's here in my life. It's in dealing with my family. It's in dealing with my friends. It's in work and the strangers that I meet going to the store. That here I begin to experience the glow of God shining through. And that glow reminds me that God is present in everyone. And with that glow, then I can begin to praise God. I can say, truly, God is in this place. Truly, God loves and cares for His people. Truly, God is concerned for all of us, no matter what our situation. And as that lasts a little bit longer and a little bit longer, slowly I begin to realize that I'm moving into a place of living in the constant presence of God. I don't need mountaintops anymore. I don't need that kind of, they're good, don't get me wrong. She says, they're still good. But what I find is that I've got what I need in dealing with the people around me, living with them, experiencing God working in their lives just as God is working in my life. That mountaintop experience showed Jesus as Jesus really is. Not the personification in human form that He took on in order to walk amongst us. But as part of the Trinity, that glow of God filling Him and filling the space around Him. On the mountaintop, we see Elijah, the one who is the prophet of prophets, taken up, did not die, but instead was taken up into heaven. And as such is that personification of all the prophets, the ones who came to tell us, you know you're messing up, you know you're turning away from God, you know you're not doing what you should be doing. Pay attention to what God has taught you. What did He teach you? This is where Moses steps in, because Moses is the one who brought the law. Carrying it down off of the mountain, he gave it to the people. Here, these are the guidelines. These are the parameters for life. These are what you need to pay attention to. How you love God, how you love your neighbor, how you love yourself. We know that following the law still produced a lot of hard times. They weren't always able to do that very well. And as you read through the prophets, you can see that they constantly say, you're getting it wrong, you're messing up, turn back, pay attention. And we know that didn't work very well either.
So here God comes along and says, I'm going to show just a little bit more of myself to you. I'm going to reveal something so that when you pull it back up in your mind, you'll go, ah, that's what God is talking about. He's talking about how I can care for others. He's talking about how I show them God's love through my actions. He's talking about how I can be a part of what God is doing to transform this world. Maybe if I can hold on to that just a little bit longer through my life, I'll be able to help more people to be transformed by the presence of God, to be the people who show love, who show compassion, who show mercy one to another. So I'm grateful for this text. I'm grateful for the fact that it comes around year after year after year, because as it comes around and as it reminds me of God's love, it reminds me also that I have a responsibility to take what I receive, this love that God's poured into me, and say, take it into the world. I want you to show that love to everybody. I want you to live with respect and compassion and mercy and kindness. I want you to help. I want you to heal people. I'm not one that can lay hands on someone and have them relieved of their distress. God has not imparted that gift to me. That is for others. But He has given me the ability to speak of His love so as to help people to understand that God's love brings about healing in your heart. It reveals the healing that God wants to give to your spirit. It reveals this presence that says, I will never leave you nor forsake you, in a way that hopefully will strengthen you to go forward day after day after day. And by that, I pray that you all may know hope as well. I don't impart this to just anybody. I impart it to everybody. And you've got that responsibility as well. You hear the stories. You've got the mental image. You can see a dazzling white, blinding flash of Jesus. Just imagine it and then multiply it a little bit, okay? And with that, then hear the words of Peter. Lord, it's good to be here. Shall I build you 3 shelters? Booths. Sukkots. The things they lived in out in the desert as they were traveling their 40 years in the wilderness. Shall we build places to shade you from the sun so that you may take your rest and remain among us? It's true, he didn't know what else to say. But what he said was what we would say. Oh Lord, don't leave. Don't go away. Stay. Help us. Heal us. God does stay. In and through each of us, we have that help we need to help others. We have the healing we need to heal others. We have the hope we need to lift others up and tell them that they're going to be okay. And what I pray is that today, this refreshment, this reminder, will be that which gives you the strength to go forward from this place and share that good news with others. You see, this is God's plan for transforming the world. That in witnessing the reality of who Jesus truly is, we're transformed
but transformed so as to say, you have got to meet Jesus. What an incredible opportunity. May God lead you, guide you, strengthen you, teach you. May He use you for His glory. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
May we pray. Oh Lord, continue to watch over us. Help us to experience Your presence with us. And may we know Your love, Your mercy, and Your grace. This we pray through Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
And so be strong, be courageous, be steadfast in your faith, and let all that you do be done in love. Amen.